You're insecure, don't know what for. You're turning heads when you walk through the door. Don't need makeup to cover up. Being the way that you are is enough. Everyone else in the room can see it. Everyone else but you. Baby, you light up my world like nobody else. The way that you flip your hair gets me overwhelmed. But when you smile at the ground, it ain't hard to tell. You don't know, you don't know you're beautiful. If only you saw what I can see, you'll understand why I want you so desperately. Right now I'm looking at you and I can't believe. You don't know, you don't know you're beautiful. That's what makes you beautiful.
In the 1880s, the place we know now as Bryn Mawr became the land of one of Auckland's business districts, later becoming a railway station, many warehouses and trading sites, and later on the chief post office. However, the train terminus was relocated to Beach Road in the 1930s, and the Bryn Mawr station soon became a bus terminal. In 1958, Auckland's first parking building was opened next to the bus terminal. But sadly, in the following years, Bryn Mawr took a downfall due to lack of investment and increasing deterioration, and for 30 years lay forgotten. Two New Zealand architectural firms were given the task to design the railway station, Jess Max and Mario Madejas Architecture, saying the design needed to celebrate railway travel and it also needed to capture the spirit of Auckland. Approximately 5:40 a.m. on the 23rd of June 2003, the first train arrived at Bryn Mawr Underground train station. On July 25th, 2003, Bryn Mawr was officially opened. Bryn Mawr today is looked upon to be a place that celebrates its past and its future. By this, Bryn Mawr will continue to be a link of the old and the new.
What about the social space here? Like we talk about how with the Bryn Mawr development, we have this new kind of public urban space. And let's face it, Auckland doesn't have a lot of public open space. But look at it. What kind of public space is this? Is there in fact what we once would have called public space, as distinct from private space, and you know, space that is privately owned? Isn't this, although it's a public thoroughfare, open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, but isn't this a space for commodification? Isn't this a space that has been renewed, civically, urban renewal, precisely to afford the possibility for Juliet Hogan, Karen Walker, Bobby Brown, For all of these, this is now a real kind of fashion center for Auckland. Hasn't this transformation actually enabled these particular commercial firms to locate themselves in key zones and key areas and have this the local government pay for the amenity to bring the public to them. Now, is that a bad thing? Well, let's say it's not absolutely devastatingly bad, but let's face it, it is the commercialization and commodification of public space. Coupled with that, precisely because it's now a valuable zone for commercial activity, there are all of those frameworks around surveillance, usually benign surveillance, CCTV surveillance and so on, that is constant, 24/7 constant in, you can see up here. The extent to which the public and private now no longer have any clear boundaries, that what we call privacy and what we call publicity constitute each other in a reciprocal framework of mutual identity. Our privacy is something that is constructed publicly. And I think in terms of what the modern metropolis is concerned with and what Britomart in our urban archaeology exemplifies is precisely this framework.
Thank you.
Benjamin says this, memory is not an instrument for the reconnaissance of what is past, but rather its medium. It is the medium of that which has been lived out, just as the soil is the medium in which old cities lie buried. Whoever seeks to gaze more closely at one's own buried past must proceed like a man who excavates. Above all, he must not shy away from coming back time and time again to one and the same object. Scatter it just as one scatters earth. Root it up just as one roots up the soil.